The Signal Oil Program, The Whistler. That whistle is your signal for the Signal Oil Program, The Whistler. I know many things, for I walk by night. I know many strange tales hidden in the hearts of men and women who have stepped into the shadows. Yes, I know the nameless terrors of which they dare not speak. Yes, friends, it's time for the Signal Oil Program, The Whistler. Rated by independent research, the most popular West Coast program in radio history. In gasoline, you know, it takes extra quality to give you extra mileage. And Signal is the famous Go Farther gasoline. So look for the Signal circle sign in yellow and black that identifies friendly dealer-owned Signal service stations from Canada to Mexico. Now the Whistler's strange story. Backlash.
They sat at the table in silence, the dinner almost over. George Turner on one side and his wife Jan opposite him. George could feel the tension between them growing from the moment Jan's Aunt Irene had excused herself to take the telephone call. It was a difficult situation. George had always hated Aunt Irene with all his heart. Only the housing shortage and the prospect of rent-free lodging had induced George to bring Jan to Irene's home and humbly ask permission to stay there. Of course, it was difficult for a man like George to be humble under any circumstances. And by now he was telling himself that it would be the greatest of all possible pleasures to kill Aunt Irene with his bare hands. The muffled sound of her voice was still coming from the next room when George looked up from his tapioca pudding to find Jan watching him quietly.
George.
What?
Well, I don't quite know how to say this, darling.
Go ahead and say it. This is jump on George and I, haven't you heard?
No one's jumping on you, George. I just wish you'd try to understand. Uncle David means a great deal to me, you know. And
so what? What do you owe Uncle David? What's he ever done for you?
Oh, is that the only standard you ever judge people by? What they've done for you. The point is, Uncle David's sick. And I feel that it's right to go to him.
You mean Aunt Irene feels that it's right?
Oh.
It was her idea in the first place. Why not admit it?
It's my idea, too, George.
Now, listen to me, Jan. This is no time for you to travel 3,000 miles across the country to visit an ailing uncle. And don't give me that drivel about owing it to him. Unfortunately, it's not a matter of loyalty. It's a matter of geography. Is that clear?
Yes, George. I suppose it is.
Well, Aunt Irene?
It was Uncle David's physician, Jan, long distance. He says it's only a matter of days now.
Thank heaven.
Oh, George.
At least we'll have something new to talk about at dinner.
George Turner is...
Aunt Irene, please!
Well, I wonder what Uncle David thinks. He's always got the world in all of you, Jan.
Oh, I... Please, Aunt Irene. I'd rather not talk about it now.
Of course, dear. I know how disappointed you must be. After all, Uncle David...
Irene, will you forget Uncle David?
I will not, George Turner, and don't you dare use that tone of voice on me. This is my house.
Good Lord, you have to throw that in my face every night at dinner.
Oh, you're just like your brother, aren't you? You look enough alike to be twins, and what's worse... You're cut from the same cloth.
Oh, Aunt Irene.
Don't stop her, Jan. Don't stop her. She loves it. Like a kid sticking a pin through a bug.
Your brother Ed's a criminal. I put him where he belongs.
Sure, Ed's a criminal. He belongs in prison. But that's not the point. The really horrible part is the morbid delight that showed on your face, dear Aunt Irene, the day you took the stand and sent him up.
Everything I testified was true.
Yes. But the only thing that never came out was your reason. You thought if Ed went up, I'd be ruined, and Jan would leave me.
Stop it, George.
Oh, no. Let's have it all on the table. You testified against Ed, hoping you would get Jan away from me. You let us come to live here so you'd have a better chance to get Jan away from me. Now you want her to go 3,000 miles across the country just so you can get her away from me.
That's not true. Not a word of it. But by heaven, you've given me an idea. If I thought I could save Jan from the misery you'll bring down on her head, I'd...
So at last it comes out. Well, go ahead, Irene. Do your darndest. But I'll warn you in advance, it won't work. It won't work because my brother Ed and I are cut from the same cloth. Remember?
Yes, George, it's all out on the table. And as you stomp out of the house and walk alone down the street of the dark Elmine Street and try and cool off, it all goes round and round in your mind. You know that Irene means what she says. After a quarrel like that, she will try to separate you from Jan. And you know, too, that you'll never let that happen. That you won't stand by and lose the only person in the world, yourself excepted, who ever meant anything to you. So the idea begins to grow, George. And the next day at the office, it's still there, like a hangover. And you find it hard to concentrate on your work.
Anderson's usually pretty thorough in covering his territory. Pretty hard to see how he could have missed Bradshaw.
Martin. What account was that?
Bradshaw.
Oh, yeah, Bradshaw. That's at San Vicente.
What are you talking about? Bradshaw does get mid-deal. Oh. You've been on these books long enough to know that.
Of course, sure. I'm sorry, Martin. I just...
Mr. Turner?
Yes?
I've been wanting to see you.
Excuse me, Martin. Who is it?
Oh, he wouldn't give me his name.
Why not?
Over there at the counter. The little man in the dark suit.
Thanks. Yes, sir?
You're George Turner?
That's right.
I ran across a little item I thought you might be interested in. 50 cents for the whole of it.
What?
What? Seen it before?
Where did you get it?
A friend.
That's all, just this?
A note comes with it. Want to take a look?
Let me see it, quick.
Take it easy. The dame over there is looking at us. Here. You interested?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm interested.
Good. Room 238, Franklin Hotel. 10 tomorrow morning.
He picks up the note and leaves, pausing a moment at the office door to toss you a wink. And you look again at the 50 cent piece with a hole. It's like a magic charm, isn't it, George? The minute you saw it, the dull ache inside you vanished. Aunt Irene, the crisis, Sam Split West. It was all unimportant after all, wasn't it? Yes. That 50 cent piece is going to make everything so simple.
Martin?
Yes?
You don't mind if I knock off for a few minutes, will you?
Why not?
I'll be right back. My wife's going west, you know, probably tomorrow.
And, I thought you talked her out of it.
Oh, not a chance. It's a favorite uncle and all that. I want to pick up a corsage for at the florist. And another thing, Martin, where was that place you bought the candy the other day? That was the best candy I ever tasted.
Valentine's on 8th Street.
Oh, yeah. Great. I want to get a box for Aunt Irene. It's about time I did something for the old girl.
With the prologue of Backlash, the Signal Oil Company brings you another strange story by The Whistler. But now here's an important announcement about a change in time for The Whistler. Beginning next Monday, The Whistler will be heard each week 1 hour earlier at 8 o'clock instead of 9. Remember, beginning next Monday, The Whistler, 1 hour earlier, 8 o'clock instead of 9. Friends, at the beginning of this program, you hear me say, in gasoline, it takes extra quality to give you extra mileage, and Signal is the famous go-farther gasoline. But just what does Signal mean by that word quality? Well, translated into driving language, gasoline quality means quicker starts, faster pickups, smoother, knock-free power. In order for Signal to give you that kind of performance, the thrill of alert, surging power that puts extra pressure into driving, Signal gasoline must help your motor run more efficiently. And when your motor runs more efficiently, you naturally get extra mileage. That's why Signal says your best yardstick of gasoline quality is your speedometer. Check yours, and you'll find it's true. In gasoline, it takes extra quality to give you extra mileage. And remember, Signal is the famous go-farther gasoline. The reason why drivers who want tops in gasoline quality, and those who appreciate extra value, are switching to Signal. Now back to the Whistler.
Ahead but dreary months of fencing with a vicious, dominating woman, of silent, tense evenings at the dinner table, while she picked away at the heart of your marriage to Jenny, of useless wages and long, lonely walks and nights. But it's over now. You can see daylight ahead. And the thing that made the difference, Jenny will be the pocket. The 50-cent piece with a hole in it that the furtive little man left for you this afternoon. You arrive home on schedule, a box of chocolates and jams corsage held playfully behind your back.
Anybody home? Sam? Am I ringing? Oh, there you are.
Good evening, George.
Oh, hello. Can I hurry in? Where's Jim?
She'll be out in a minute. Oh, it's the door is drafted. I've something to tell you, George.
Great. I'm listening.
I had a long talk with Sam today.
Oh.
We decided, we, mind you, not I, should entirely unfair about the truth.
I see.
George, Jan is leaving tomorrow to visit Uncle David. And nothing you will say will change her mind. Is that clear?
Of course.
Well, is that all you're going to say?
I think it's a wonderful idea. The trouble doing good.
Mr. Crowley, the church payment.
I'll get it up.
Sit down, Benton.
inhibits your brother's strength. Maybe they don't like your brother.
Tomorrow? It's not better. This money was not spent, well. That's only because this time we had available, or this person had turned him back.
Yeah, I get it. Little person, sir. That is because this man would have been in the wrong place. Secondly, I'd be gorgeous. But the same height and same build that you could transport him. And that's why I'm seeing him. Yeah. Now, if you still be wrong, I'd be a little person.
Heard the news on the radio, too.
I don't suppose you were going to tell me.
Well, I didn't see any point in alarming you. It'll be in the paper soon enough.
You'd like Ed to come here, wouldn't you? You're probably counting on it.
Oh, now, please, Aunt Irene. Haven't I been trying my best to get along?
He'll try to kill me. He swore he would that day in the courtroom.
Now, Aunt Irene, he wouldn't try anything that foolish. Why, all the police in the state will be watching this area.
This amuses you, doesn't it, George? The fact that I wanted Jan to go away, that I'm alone in this house.
You're not alone. I'll be here. And if it'll make you feel any better, I'll phone my friend, Lieutenant Andrews. I'll tell him you want police protection.
You'd really do that for me, George?
Why, sure. So, just take it easy, Aunt Irene. Everything's going to be perfectly all right.
You don't intend to phone, do you, George? You get Irene to go to her room, and then you sneak down to your car in the alley where you left it. You toss the bundle of clothes into the back and drive to a secluded spot at the edge of town. It doesn't take long to change from your suit into the old one of Ed. And a bit of dirt rubbed on your face makes the disguise more perfect. You're thinner than Ed, yes. But even Frawley remarked how much you look alike. Back in town, you run the car into an alley, cut the lights, and walk the few short blocks to Brunelli's Bar, a place that has changed very little since the days when Ed used to hang around. This is an important step, George. You must establish Ed's presence in town.
Hello, boys. Surprised to see me?
Ed.
Watch it, Brunelli. Don't do anything foolish. You see, I haven't got anything to lose. You have.
Ed, hey, you gotta go quick, Ed. The police will be...
The police are figuring I'm 100 miles from here.
Well, what do you want?
I'm short of cash, Brunelli. Very short. I thought you'd like to give me 50 bucks.
No. I can't do that. I can't help a criminal, Ed.
So you believe it too, huh? All that lying old dame had to say.
Well, you had a fair trial.
Sure, and they hung it on me. So now I want a fair chance to even things up and beat it. The money, Brunelli. Get it out of the register.
But, Ed...
Get it!
All right, I'll get it. This is no good, Eddie. They could close me down.
So could I. Thanks. Just don't any of you do anything until I'm away from here. I wouldn't like it. And maybe killing comes easier for me now.
It wasn't easy, George. But you know as you hurry back to your car that there were four people in that bar who will swear Ed Turner was in town tonight, at large. 5 minutes later, you pull into a service station, change clothes in the washroom, and scrub the dirt from your face. No one pays any attention as you toss the little bundle of Ed's clothes in the back of a truck which is pulled in for gas. The next thing is your alibi, just in case something should go wrong. You drive over to the theater in your own neighborhood. The picture is one you saw a week ago on a business trip. Before going in, you purposely stop and chat a minute with the manager. Then you go inside, take a seat near the fire exit, and sit down to wait. Half an hour later, you decide it's time. You get up, unnoticed, and walk toward the fire door, fumbling in your pocket. Your hand lights on the 50-cent piece. And as you slip out, you insert it carefully into place, holding back the latch. Yes, George, you'll want to be able to get back to the theater when the night's business is over. After you've murdered Aunt Irene. It's only a few minutes to the house from the theater. You walk with quick, determined steps. This part won't be difficult, will it, George? No, you can't wait to walk in on her.
Hey, wait a minute, what's...
Hello, George.
What's the matter, Lieutenant Andrews?
A little late to be getting home from work, isn't it?
What? No, I was home before. I just went out for a little walk.
What brought you back, George? Forget something? Or did you want to make sure your wife's aunt was dead?
Whistler will return in just a moment with a strange ending to tonight's story. Meantime, since this is spring, the season when a young man's thoughts turn to love, and also to oil changes, if he has a car, I'd like to say a word tonight on both subjects. Love, that is, and oil changes. If you really love your car and want to keep it young, happy, and purring with contentment, make this spring's oil change a change for the better. In short, make it a change to that amazing new type Signal lubricant that's your guarantee of a sweeter running motor, Signal Premium Motor Oil. You see, because it combines five scientific new compounds with 100% pure paraffin base, Signal Premium Motor Oil does much more than just lubricate. In fact, tests prove Signal Premium actually keeps motors 6 times cleaner and reduces cylinder wear 1/3. So remember, if you want a sweeter running motor, if you want to keep wear down and performance up, the oil to change to this spring is Signal Premium Motor Oil. And the place to get it? Your friendly neighborhood Signal service station. And now back to the Whistler.
Well, George, you stand there speechless, stunned. Almost as if someone had struck you with a sledgehammer when you walked through the door. Aunt Irene lying on the floor, dead. Andrews from the homicide squad staring at you, his lean face full of questions. You never figured it this way, did you, George? Not with Frawley's promise that they'd have Ed in Mexico 12 hours after his prison break. But now it begins to make sense, doesn't it? Ed must have decided not to leave without evening the score with Aunt Irene. You take your time, thinking it all through before saying anything. And then you realize that it's better this way. Ed's safely out of town by now, but he'll be blamed if you simply say you saw him. And you can say that, George, because Grinnelli and those people in the bar will back you up. Yes, it's better this way.
You want to tell us what happened, George?
Yeah, sure, Andrews. It was just an awful shock, that's all. I guess it's pretty simple. My brother, Ed, he was in town this evening.
You talked to him?
No, I saw him, though. I don't think there could be any mistake. And, of course, you know how he felt about Aunt Irene.
Yeah, we know. Only we're more interested in how you felt about her, George.
What do you mean?
Mr. Cameron here says you hated her enough to kill her.
Wait a minute. You're not accusing me.
That's exactly what I'm doing.
Yes, only last week at the garden club, Irene...
Yeah, you've told us all that, Mr. Cameron.
All right, so we did quarrel, so I hated her, but that doesn't mean I killed her.
He's lying, Lieutenant. I heard her scream. I heard him run out of the house.
It was my brother. It must have been my brother. He swore he'd kill her. You've got to find him. He's on his way to Mexico.
He's on his way, all right, but not to Mexico. He was killed less than an hour ago in a running battle with the police.
That doesn't make any difference. I tell you, he came here...
George, we know you're lying. You see, 4 witnesses are ready to swear that at the exact moment of the murder, your brother was downtown in Grinnelli's bar.
Let that whistle be your signal for the Signal Oil program, The Whistler. Each Monday at 9, brought to you by the Signal Oil Company, marketers of Signal gasoline and motor oil and fine quality automotive accessories. Now let me remind you once more, beginning next Monday, The Whistler will be heard 1 hour earlier, 8 o'clock instead of 9. Featured in tonight's story were Howard Duff and Henrietta Tedrow. The Whistler was produced by George W. Allen with music by Wilbur Hatch, story by J. Douglas Ware, and was transmitted to our troops overseas by the Armed Forces Radio Service. This is Marvin Miller speaking for the Signal Oil Company. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.